إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما نبينا المصطفى ومن بسنته وآثاره اقتدى واقتفى واكتفى. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، فصلى الله عليه صلاة وسلاما يليقان بمقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds all of us about being conscious about Allah, about protecting ourselves from the anger of Allah. Allah says in the Quran, بعد أن أعود لله من الشيطان الرجيم، يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم. O people, fear your Lord and be conscious about Him, because the quake on the day of judgment is an immense event that is bound to happen. The title of my khutbah today is Inspired by Malcolm. Inspired by Malcolm X, Al-Hajj Malik al-Shabazz, رحمه الله سبحانه وتعالى. Last week, and particularly on February 21st, it was the 50th anniversary of the death, of the assassination of this great man, of this great leader. Some people come to this world and they leave and nobody even noticed that they existed, because they lived for themselves. They lived for their desires. They lived to make a living. They lived just for the sake of earning and earning and taking. Whereas Brother Malcolm, rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even 50 years after his death, people remember him. Even 50 years after his death, people are accepting Islam. People are tasting the sweetness and the beauty of this great religion after being inspired by Malcolm X. I gave this khutbah in other communities, and every time I give it, I get someone from the audience who tell me, oh brother, I accepted Islam after hearing the story of Malcolm X, after watching the movie, after being inspired by Malcolm. Actually, last week, a brother told me that he read his book 5 times, the autobiography of Malcolm X, 2 times before he accepted Islam and 3 times after he accepted Islam. Allahu Akbar. So 50 years after his death, and people are still inspired, although he didn't live much. He died at the age of 39. 20 years of that was his pre-ignorance period, when he was before outside the jail, you know. So even half of his age, half of his life, subhanAllah, was spent in heedlessness and in jahiliya, in ignorance. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses certain people to inspire thousands, if not millions, to come. To shed some light on the story of Malcolm X, I will focus on 3 items only, because this is a very short time to talk about a great man like Malcolm, rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first one is the Muslim identity. It's the American Muslim identity, and being proud of it and denouncing any form of racism and encouraging this belonging, this brotherhood under this great deen. You know what made Brother Malcolm accept Islam when he was in the jail? Is the teachings of Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam. And that was a reaction to what he perceived as the white supremacy, that the white man is evil. And after all the, you know, struggle and the jihad that our African-American and African brothers experienced from the white man, from the white Christian man, according to his, you know, ideology, he accepted Islam. So what brought him to Islam is this seek, this search for justice, for equality, for brotherhood between mankind. So this is what brought him to the Nation of Islam, which is a diverted, you know, version of Islam. But then what brought him to true Islam is after he went to the Hajj, to Mecca, and experienced the true brotherhood. When he saw those white men as he saw them before, they are not evil. They're serving him food. They're helping him do the tawaf. They are helping him, and you know they are extending their hands to him. He's like, these people cannot be evil. So Islam can always be an ideology, a set of rules and regulations. But before people see true Islam in your manners, in your nice way, in your kindness, then people cannot get to the beauty of this deen. Islam is not meant to be put on the shelves, on the bookshelves. Islam is a religion, is a way of life that should be expressed in our manners and in our behavior. Malcolm experienced this even after he became a Muslim and he became a preacher for the Nation of Islam, brotherhood with all, even with the non-Muslims, even with the sinners, even with the gangsters in the streets of Harlem and Boston, even those who we might look down to because they are living a miserable life, his methodology was to extend our hand, to love them. We love them, but we hate what they do. We love them because they are human beings. Because Allah has dignified and honored human beings. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ This is a very important concept that I know we know about it. All of us here, we don't need to be reminded about it. But are we truly practicing it? Are we truly eliminating the barriers between ethnic groups? And are we truly embodying the teachings of Islam as Brother Malcolm saw in Mecca and how he accepted Islam and he loved Islam after seeing this amazing deen embodied in the behavior of people? What's interesting about Malcolm X and the issue of Muslim identity is that he belonged to three different worlds. He was a Muslim, he was American, and he was African. And wherever he went, subhanAllah, he stuck to these two, three identities and didn't try to take one over the others. Yes, I'm a Muslim, but I'm American. And he did not give up his American identity. He was so proud of it. And he was teaching Americans how true America is. He was teaching the racist people among his people how I should embody my American values and how I should embody true brotherhood. And here in our community, we have a lot of youth. Actually, most of us here are either immigrants or sons of immigrants or sons of sons of sons of immigrants. So all of us of here in this community, in this country, are immigrants of second, third, fourth, fifth generation. And many of those communities experienced some torture, some discrimination back in the days. So the idea is you have to be proud of who you are. You have to be an American, a Muslim American who fights for your rights. And subhanAllah, nowadays Muslims are experiencing a lot of hate. A lot of hate crimes. A lot of propaganda in the media against Muslims. And the question is, what will be our reaction? Are we going to embody the true meaning of being American and Muslim and being, you know, working for our rights and being active in our community? In his diary, Brother Malcolm said, after reflecting on his Hajj experience, maybe Islam could help America to solve her nagging race problems. Allahu Akbar. Look at how he's looking for solutions for his community. He's like that, you know what, I'm going to denounce all of this community. I don't belong to it. No. I want Islam to be the solution for the problems. I want Islam to be the solution for the racism in America. So the idea is, don't give up your identity. Sisters, your hijab might be hated by others, but maybe your hijab is the solution to the problems that you are facing. Maybe the modesty, maybe our brothers, when they stay away from partying or drinking or whatever, maybe when you say, no, I don't do this, this is the solution for the others. Actually, it's not maybe, it's definitely. Insha'Allah, bi'ithnillah. But you have to learn and you have to reflect on the story of Malcolm X. So the first message, the first take-home message is, be proud of who you are. And probably the iman, the faith that you have in your heart is what others are fighting for. That was the first message. The second message and the second reflection after reading about Brother Malcolm is how amazing Allah guides people. What I call in my notes, the equation of guidance. How guidance touches a human heart. How someone is guided. Sometimes we think as Muslims, as carriers of this faith, that it's all about debating with others, showing them the truth, that's it, you have to accept. It's about winning arguments, winning debates. Although the story of Malcolm, in addition to many other stories of brothers that are with us in this room who accepted Islam, that guidance is not something that you can write an equation for. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You don't guide whoever you want. Allah guides whoever He wants. Actually, the word يَشَاء, as our scholars reflect on, it has two subjects. Two people should will for this argument, for this guidance. يَشَاء means Allah يَشَاء. Allah has to allow this guidance, but also يَشَاء means you have to accept this guidance. So the equation of guidance, it will not come to you while you are sitting and doing nothing. You have to put some effort and Allah will guide you. Whereas if you're waiting for a miracle to happen to be guided, no. This doesn't work this way. So I will zoom into the story of how Malcolm subhanAllah started accepting Islam. So he was in the jail after being put in the jail, and he was labeled in the jail by others as the Satan. Because he was so arrogant, he was so against any idea of any religion, of any prayer, of any relation with God. But subhanAllah, he heard that his brother accepted Islam through the Nation of Islam, through the teachings of Elijah Muhammad. And then he was doubtful, he was skeptical, like many of our brothers before they accept Islam. But then he reads this hadith, this narration, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who said, مَنْ تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيْهِ شِبْرًا تَقَرَّبْتُ إِلَيْهِ بَاعًا وَمَنْ أَتَانِي يَمْشِي أَتَيْتُهُ هَرْوَلًا. That whoever comes to Allah, closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by an arm's length, Allah will come to him closer by two arms' length. And whoever comes to Allah walking, Allah will come to him running. What does that mean? This means that if you want guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to work for it. Even very small, tiny steps towards Allah, and Allah will guide you. Whereas if you are only taking Islam as a mental exercise, it doesn't work this way. So Brother Malcolm wanted to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is exactly what guidance is about. Show Allah some seriousness in your attitude. So what did he do? He heard that Muslims don't eat pork. So he decided to stop eating pork. Was he a Muslim? Did he take the Shahada? No, not yet. He said he wanted this very small act to be the way he comes closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he started doing this. And in the jail, all of his mates started saying, oh, Satan does not eat pork. They were like amazed by him. So subhanAllah, and he said, this is the action that I did that opened my heart towards Islam, towards submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because again, guidance, you have to work for it. And my message to our brothers who are born as Muslims, who feel they are distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who feel that they used to come to the masjid more, attend study circles, read the Quran, you know, but now they are barely keeping with their five daily prayers. My urge to you is to learn from Brother Malcolm and come at least submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and add one tiny small thing to your daily schedule. Come closer to Allah, this very small step, and see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the doors for you. And you will see yourself more attending study circles and meeting new brothers. And inshallah, maybe if you want to get married, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you, will honor you, will grant you this beautiful, righteous spouse, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We learn from Brother Michael, come closer to Allah with one step and see how the doors of guidance are opened. Allah says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who struggle and strive in our ways, we will guide them. We will guide them to it. We will open the doors of guidance towards it, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to take action, one of the things that you learn from the book of Malcolm X is his thirst for knowledge. He has an infinite search and passion for reading anything. And he says in his book that after subhanAllah accepting Islam and he wanted to learn more and more and more, he is like, you know what, I want to read. So he goes to the library of the prison and he says, subhanAllah, you can see there is some guidance. There is some divine guidance that the book, the library they had in their prison is something that was envied by other universities. Somebody donated all of their books to that library, subhanAllah. And he started reading. And guess what? He barely knew how to read because he left school when he was in eighth grade, and he could not. He forgot all of that, you know, in the street life and whatever he was doing. So he started opening the dictionary, but he cannot decipher the word in the dictionary. So he started copying every single page of the dictionary. Would read the first page with letter A, and then he would copy every single word. Then he would recite it more and more and more until he goes to the next page, until he goes to letter B, C, D, until he finishes copying all the words in the dictionary. Allahu Akbar. This is passion for knowledge. This is thirst for getting more and more out of the things that all of us here in this room are in a better position than Brother Malcolm when he was in the jail. But subhanAllah, we take knowledge for granted. So after knowing and learning how to read, he starts reading books and books and books that subhanAllah, even scholars and even PhDs in their fields, in their very specific fields, would not read nowadays. He said that he used to read 15 hours a day. Allahu Akbar. 15 hours a day out of the 24 hours. He would stay awake till 3 a.m. reading. And he would read, you know, when he was in his cell, he would read from the light that is in the corridor, which is very far from him, and he would always have every 58 minutes to make fake that he's sleeping because the guards would come and see him as awake. And he was hiding that he was reading, actually. SubhanAllah. So again, my urge to my brothers and sisters, Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Are they the same? Those who know and those who don't know, after graduating and after finishing his time in the jail, he goes and he becomes a very active member of the Nation of Islam, and he engages in a lot of debates. And he's invited everywhere, to Harvard, to Yale, to all of those Ivory schools, and he would debate others like professors and people who are well educated, and he would defeat them all with his debates, with his strong arguments, with his deep knowledge. And whenever he's asked about his alma mater, where did you learn all of this from? He would say, I learned it from books. I learned this from true books. And subhanAllah, again, my dear respected brothers and sisters, there's no shortcut for knowledge. There's no shortcut in Islam for real knowledge. Actually, in Islam, you are commanded after taking the faith and after practicing your faith to increase your knowledge. The first command that came down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was about reading. Read about knowledge. Even before Allah told him pray or fast or destroy the idols, or even before he told him, go and preach the da'wah to the people, he told him, read. Because reading, any form of worship without reading is not accepted without knowledge. So we learn from Brother Malcolm this deep thirst for knowledge and how he used this knowledge in good ways to affect people. Brother Malcolm died at the age of 39. Very young age. And when you see how much people were affected by him and how much Islam was spread by him, even the prophets, they become prophets at the age of 40. Even the prophets, they need, you know, they need to be prepared by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before accepting this great trust of being prophets. Brother Malcolm, actually, most of his life was even before he reached the age of 40. The third lesson, the third inspiration that we should think about when we talk about Malcolm X is about leaving a legacy. Is about living a life of purpose, not living heedlessly, not living for ourselves. And this happened to Brother Malcolm despite having a very bad history. See, many of us, or some of us, they started their life in the wrong way. And they are always constantly haunted by their previous lives, by their previous sins, by their issues. And all of us are human beings, all of us do mistakes, and we will continue to do mistakes. But don't be haunted by those mistakes. Don't let them, you know, entangle you and stop you from being a great person, from being a great inspiration. Prophet Musa alayhi salam went to Fir'aun. And that was years and years after he committed the sin of killing someone by mistake. So he killed a man by mistake and he fled away from Egypt. He goes to Madian and he comes back with his family. He becomes a prophet after talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he goes back to Fir'aun. And Fir'aun starts to remind Musa about his history. Because he knows. He knows this is a problem. This is an inner struggle that all of us will have. The reflection of our mistakes. And we should not forget them. But we should not be haunted by them. So Musa goes, and Fir'aun tells him, قَالَ أَلَمْ نُرَبِّكَ فِينَا وَلِيدًا ولبثت فينا من عمرك سنين. Aren't we the ones who raised you? And you spent a lot of time being fed by my food, by my servants, by my slaves. And Pharaoh tells him, وَفَعَلْتَ فَعْلَتَكَ الَّتِي فَعَلْتَ وَأَنْتَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. Remember what you did when you were a kafir? So this is Pharaoh reminding Musa, Pharaoh the big kafir, the big zalim, reminding Musa of being the kafir. And then Musa says him, told him, قَالَ فَعَلْتُهَا إِذَنْ وَأَنَا مِنَ الضَّالِّينَ فَفَرَرْتُ مِنْكُمْ لَمَّا خِفْتُكُمْ فَوَهَبَ لِي رَبِّي حُكْمًا وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. I did this when I was going astray. I escaped from you because I was afraid from you, but Allah gave me prophethood. Allah gave me wisdom. So he's saying it's not because of my strength, because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this, subhanAllah, Musa facing himself and exposing himself and talking about his previous mistakes without being haunted by them. So living a life of purpose is what made Brother Malcolm, subhanAllah, till this day, brothers and sisters, thousands of people affected by his great life. In order to do this, he had to remove the ego out of the equation. Because many of those who work for Islam, their ego becomes a problem. They are yusharu ilayhi bil banan. People are, you know, oh, this is the scholar, this is the speaker, this is the activist, blah, blah, blah. And Brother Malcolm, wherever he goes, he is on the spotlight, but he always reminded the people that it's not me. It is the messenger of Allah, which according to him was Elijah Muhammad. And he would always show them, you know, his picture. Don't put my picture, put his picture. Because it's not about me. It's not about the ego. It's not about my name. It's about the message. Brother Malcolm reminds me of Imam Malik, rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Malik wrote his great, huge book in the science of hadith, Al-Muwatta. When he authored this book, and it was available, other scholars became jealous from Imam Malik. And they started writing other books, and they called them Al-Muwatta. So Al-Muwatta for Imam so-and-so, and Al-Muwatta for Imam so-and-so. And the students of Imam Malik were very frustrated. How like they are fighting, they are jumping on the same wagon. How are they doing this? This will affect the quality of your book. Your book won't be known. You spend so much effort in it, and these other people are just taking the name. And Imam Malik said a very profound statement. He said, مَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ يَبْقَى مَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ يَبْقَى. Whoever was, anything that was done for the sake of Allah, it will remain. It will prevail. It will continue. And if something was done for the sake of ego or some temporary enjoyment or for money, it will just stop there. مَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ يَبْقَى. And I can tell, وَلَا نُزَكِّي عَلَى اللَّهِ أَحَدًا, that life of that great man was for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by seeing the fruits of his message, of his legacy, of his book, of his life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all of us and make all of us inspired by Malcolm X. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all of us, inshallah, inspiration for other brothers and sisters, Muslims and non-Muslim. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and guide people through us and make us reasons for those to be guided. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, last week was the 50th anniversary of the death of a great man, of the assassination of a great man. But people can come to this life and leave, but their ideologies, their idea, their legacy will still be there. And we are talking about a legacy that is still alive 50 years after his death. And many people I know personally are touched by Malcolm X, and they are accepting this Islam. Or they are born as Muslims, and they are tasting the sweetness of this Islam, and again and again. And as I mentioned, there are three main items that we can be touched and inspired by Brother Malcolm. The first one is to be proud of our Muslim identity, American or Muslim-American identity, and to stop and remove any barriers of racism between ourselves. And the second one is how to get guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Extend your hand and you will be guided. Do a little effort and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide you. And the third lesson and the first legacy that the life of Malcolm teaches us is to leave a legacy, is to live a life of purpose, is to live for others, is to include Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and include the message of Allah and include this great deen in your legacy and don't live for yourself. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide all of us, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless and mercy the soul of Brother Malcolm X, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inspire all of us by his life, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow all of us to read his book inshallah and benefit from his legacy. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين وانصرنا على القوم الظالمين وانصرنا على القوم المعتدين. اللهم برحمتك نرجو ومن عذابك نستجير. اللهم برحمتك نستغيث. لا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين ولا أقل من ذلك. اللهم إنك إن تكلنا إلى أنفسنا فإنك تكلنا إلى ضعف وعورة، وإنا لا نثق إلا بقدرتك يا رب العالمين. اللهم تب علينا لنتوب، اللهم تب علينا لنتوب، اللهم تب علينا لنتوب. اللهم بلغنا رمضان، اللهم بلغنا رمضان، اللهم بلغنا رمضان، ووفقنا فيه للإحسان وقراءة القرآن والصيام وغض البصر وحفظ اللسان. وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.